Good morning. I hope you're feeling sharp today and that you're ready for all the challenges, and God bless you as we share together in this devotion. Wake up and smell the roses. Have you ever heard someone say that? Some roses no longer have a scent, usually because they are hybrids. Some people have a very acute sense of smell. They immediately pick up a new scent. Others have no sense of smell or have lost it due to COVID or other illness. Isn't the smell of the rain or freshly cut grass such a pleasure? And jasmine in full flower almost stops me in my tracks. I've often thought about the smell in the temple or the tabernacle. The slaughtering of animals. Listen to what Leviticus says. It says, if the offering is a burnt offering from the flock, from either the sheep or the goats, you are to offer a male without defect. You are to slaughter it at the north side of the altar before the Lord, and Aaron's sons, the priests, shall splash its blood against the sides of the altar. And you are to cut it into pieces, and the priest shall arrange them, including the head and the fat, on the wood that is burning on the altar. And you are to wash the internal organs and the legs with water, and the priest is to bring all of them and burn them on the altar. It is a burnt offering, a food offering, an aroma pleasing to God. An aroma pleasing to God. I can't imagine anything that smells worse than the entrails being being squeezed out and washed and cleansed right there in the temple, doing it in the church. They're doing it to be offered on the altar, and they put those things on the altar. It's a burnt offering, the burning fat, the burning meat. Imagine that smell. The temple and the burning flesh on that altar. And so right there next to the curtain, in front of the Holy of Holies, was an incense altar. Morning and evening, incense would be burnt, and the smell of incense would permeate the air and maybe freshen it up a little bit. And on the Day of Atonement, coals would be taken from off the altar and put into a censer with two hands full of incense. And the high priest would take that into the Holy of Holies, and he would present it before the mercy seat and the Ark of the Covenant. Aren't you glad we no longer have to do that, to bring your bottle of air freshener spray just to go to church? It is important to note that what may be a terrible stench for you and I is an aroma pleasing to God. And that says a lot of things to me. It says a lot of things to me. It says that no matter how bad I am, it says to me no matter how broken I am, how sinful I am, I can be an aroma pleasing to God by His grace and the new birth that I have in Christ. But we also got to understand that when Jesus bore our sins on the cross, it was not only for the polite and the socially acceptable misdemeanors of upper-class society. It was for the murder, the brutality, the abuse, the corruption, the vile acts of degenerate men and women. Think of the most repulsive action of mankind. It was for that that Jesus died. And that was laid on the sinless and righteous shoulders of Jesus, causing him to cry out, my God, why have you forsaken me? What a stench that must have been in his nostrils. But that sacrifice was an aroma pleasing to God. But there's more to that. We are told that we've got to wear the aroma of God. Listen to what Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 14. He says, "But thanks be to God, who always leads us as captives in Christ's triumphal procession and uses us to spread the aroma of the knowledge of him everywhere. For we are to God the pleasing aroma of Christ amongst those who are being saved and those who are perishing. To the one, we are an aroma that brings death. To the other, an aroma that brings life. And who is equal to such a task? Unlike so many, we do not peddle the word of God for profit. On the contrary, in Christ we speak before God with sincerity as those sent from God." So are you up to that? Are you up to being the aroma of God? And to those who are dying, it's repulsive. But to those who are living, who have life eternal, it is something that is beautiful. It is something that is good. We come in a triumphal procession, says Paul. And he uses us to spread the aroma of the knowledge of him. I had to ask myself the question, do people smell God on me? That's quite a question. I don't know how to answer it. Do people smell God on me? He uses us to spread the aroma of the knowledge of him. We are that pleasing aroma to those who are saved and to those who are perishing. And from the stench and deprivation of our sin, there's no sin too bad or too repulsive. We become the pleasing aroma of Jesus, our Savior. Hallelujah! What a Savior! Let us pray. Lord, you really stooped down and picked us up from sinking sand. You lifted us from the deprivation of sin and the brokenness of lives that were in rebellion against you. Stinking lives. You came and you brought an aroma of salvation. And that's what we want to focus on, Lord, not the bad smell. We want to focus on the reality that there is a pleasant aroma from the sacrifice that we bring when we offer our lives to you. You come in and you make us the aroma of God amongst people. That pleasing aroma. People look to us and they see you, Lord, and they see something that is pleasing. And that's terrifying to me. It's terrifying that people look to me to see Jesus. And sometimes they do turn away disappointed. And I come, Lord Jesus, and I ask that you would take possession of our lives. Take possession of my life. I can't give your life to Christ, but only you can. That, Lord, you would come and take possession of my life in such a way that it would be a fragrant aroma of grace and mercy and love. And I ask that in your name. Amen. Go well. Walk with the Lord. Live with him and spread his aroma all around. It is pleasing to God. Bye-bye.